was plain blue and white. Taking roots with your head, changing roots now and then, till the balance was right. And then you added some music. Every note was in place, and anybody could see all the changes in me by the look on my face.
Yeah. Stay, I will only be in off the way. And I will always love you. Will always love you. Bittersweet memories. We both know that I'm not what you need. And I will always love you. I will always love you. I hope treats you kind, and I hope you have all that you ever dreamed of, and I wish you joy and happiness, but above all this, I wish you love. Thank you.
Richard Wade, 74, Elk City, Oklahoma, went home to be with the Lord on Monday, December 12, 2022, at his home surrounded by his loving family. Richard was born on December 26, 1947 in Pampa, Texas to Sam B. and Fern Thompson Wade. Richard and Fern moved to Elk City at the age of six after his father died in an oil field accident. Richard grew up in Port in Elk City, Oklahoma, and was raised by his mother Fern and stepfather Leonard Sullivan. After graduating from Elk City High School, Richard served in the U.S. Army until his honorable discharge, at which point he returned to Elk City and began a long career in the oil field industry. Richard married his best friend and sweetheart, Peggy, on April 10, 1969, at the First Baptist Church in Elk City, Oklahoma. Together, they raised their two children, Stephanie and Brandon. Richard enjoyed watching the Oklahoma Sooners, TCU Horned Frogs, and the Texas Rangers. He had a love for classic cars, especially his 1955 and 56 Chevys. Fishing and golf were his hobbies, but his true passion was farming and ranching, which he did all of his adult life. He was a member of the First Baptist Church, the Masonic Lodge, number 182 of Elk City, Oklahoma. Now cherishing Richard's memory is his wife, Peggy Wade, at home, one daughter, Stephanie Deal, and her husband, Dustin, one son, Brandon Wade, and his wife, September, three grandsons, Samuel Brandon, and Jonas Sullivan, Samuel Brandon Wade and Jonas Sullivan Wade of Keller, Texas, and Cash Wade Deal of Elk City, sister-in-law Paula Watkins and her husband Kent, niece Vicki Spencer of Elk City, nephew Blaine Ostrander and his family of West Lake Village, California. Richard was preceded in death by his mother, Fern Sullivan, father Sam Wade, and stepfather Leonard Sullivan. The family would like to express deepest appreciation for the superb comfort and care afforded to Richard during his last days by Traditions Hospice. Of course, memorials can be made to the Westview Boys Home, Samaritan's Purse, or Gideon's International of Elk City. On behalf of First Baptist Church and on behalf of the family, I'd like to just welcome you here today to celebrate the life of Richard Wade. Family, I'd just like to say on behalf of Dr. Russell and I, Dr. Doug and I, that it's an honor to get to do this and to walk alongside you during this season. And I've got a few scriptures I'd like to just read very quickly for you before we pray. My hope is that as you hear these will be some places where you can hang your hat, some pieces of truth and hope that you can lean on today. Psalm 61, verses 2 and 3, says, "From the end of the earth I call to you when my heart is faint. Lead me to the rock that is higher than I, for you have been my refuge, strong tower against the enemy." And Hebrews 10:23 says, "Let us hold fast the confession of our hope without wavering, for he who promised is faithful." And lastly, 2 Timothy chapter 4, verses 7 through 8 says this, "I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. Henceforth, there is laid up for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will award to me on that day, and not only to me, but also to all who have loved his appearing." I think you would agree that that would include Richard today. Family, can I pray for you? Let's have a word of prayer. Father, we come to you with heavy hearts in the name of Jesus today. And God, I pray for this family now as they are grieving the loss of their loved one. I pray that for each of them, you would meet them right where they are in the grieving process. Lord, some of them today may need laughter. I pray that you provide that to them and give them the freedom to laugh. I pray for those that maybe need to cry today. God, that you would give them tears where they're needed, comfort where it's needed, deep in their hearts as their hearts are very troubled today. Father, I just pray that deep down in their hearts they'd be able to lean on Christ and that they would experience that sweet peace that you promised us, a peace that surpasses all understanding. And great joy today as we celebrate Richard's life. And we're going to entrust the next few moments into your hands. We're going to do that in the strong and mighty name of Jesus. Amen.
Have the peace.
Said, I like it because they never talk back or cause any trouble. And he also loved John Deere tractors. Peggy, I think you said the bigger the better. He said the bigger the better. And so he loved all things like that. Fishing, hunting, golf. Loved OU football and TCU as well. In fact, his dad, Sam, went to TCU at one time in his life. And I had such a good time the other night just reminiscing about Richard and the things that you all thought of when you think about him. Stephanie, you said he's my hero. He's the toughest guy that I know. And
I know that he battled a lot of health issues over the last 11 years or so, and there were several other times we thought he would go, and the Lord always brought him back. And so even though he had been sick, it's still a little bit of a shock and unexpected that he is not with us today. But I know, Brandon, you were telling me how much you love people and just, you know, the blessing of you all growing up on the farm and all the things having to do with that. Peggy, you all would have been married 54 years this coming April. And I know God blessed both of you by giving you to him and Richard to you as well. When you think about Richard, Richard was a guy that would reach out to people having a hard time. He was always for the underdog. Brandon, you said he always liked to come to the underdog's defense. And I know that there was a time or two in my life where he called me and he said, "Hey, I know you're going through some things. Just want you to know I care and I love you." And, you know, it means a lot to you when people reach out to you like that. And he was that kind of guy. He loved people and reaching out to them. He was a hard worker, providing for his family, working in the oil field, at a filling station, farm. The flag here reminds us of his service in the Army and how much he loved his country. And Richard truly was a patriot. If you were a nurse that maybe had cared for him in the hospital, you wouldn't be surprised if he would ask you, "Do you know Jesus?" And he wanted people to know Christ because he loved people as well. Tell you something else about Richard. He loved the Word of God. Sometimes he would call me. I remember at least two distinct times he would call me and say, I've been reading this text in the Bible, and I just wanted to know what you think it means. And I asked him, "Well, what do you think it means?" And I could tell he had been putting a lot of thought into it and reflecting upon it. And he wasn't a guy that just read his Bible, although he did. In fact, he read his Bible through six times in the past 2 years, just because of the health situation. He had more time just to be at home and do that. And I'm good if I can read the Bible through once a year. I can't imagine reading it six times in the past 2 years. So he did love God's Word, and he liked to talk with you about it and what it meant. And so these are just a lot of the things that come to mind as we think about Richard and his life, and just so grateful for him and the way that he touched our lives. You know, we gathered in this very auditorium around 9 years ago, a little over 9 years ago, when Fern, his mother, passed away. And I was thinking today, Peggy, about the verse that I used at Fern's service, and I want to just read it to all of us. It was Deuteronomy 31:8, and I hope that you all will take this to heart today. It says, "The Lord is the one who goes ahead of you. He will be with you. He will not fail you or forsake you. Do not fear or be dismayed." And you all know the truth of that. As hard as this is, you know that God is with you. He's going to help you. He's going to walk through this with you. But there's another verse I want to share today, and that's out of Psalm 73:26. We were visiting the other night about different verses that the family wanted shared, and Duncan read several of those. And Peggy, I know this is the one that has meant a lot to you. Psalm 73:26. It says, "My flesh and my heart may fail, but God is the strength of my heart and my portion forever." And that's another one that we certainly hold close at a time like this. Because death does come eventually to all of us, though in different times and different ways. Sometimes it comes at the end of a long life, and other times death comes prematurely before we're ready for it. And as I said earlier, even though Richard had battled health issues, there was an unexpectedness to this and how quickly this happened over the weekend, I think beginning early Saturday morning. And, you know, you can think you're ready, but you really never are. And so as we gather here to remember Richard,
We just want to honor him and comfort his family and remind ourselves of the hope that we have in Jesus beyond the grave. And so as we think about this verse in Psalm 73, my heart and my flesh may fail, but God is the strength of my heart and my portion forever. One thing that this verse teaches us is that life is fragile. He begins by saying, my flesh and my heart may fail. One person wrote this, quote, "We take for granted this human body. It is marvelously made, but it is not indestructible, nor was it meant to last forever. The human body is temporary and weak and vulnerable to a thousand different things which can attack it from without and from within," end of quote. And we came face to face with that truth this past early Monday morning when Richard's heart stopped. We were reminded again of the truth of this verse, that my flesh and my heart may fail. And we're reminded of the truth from this verse in the Psalms, that what he experienced, we will all experience someday. And if this verse ended there, this day would probably be harder than we could bear. But this verse goes on to say, "But God is the strength of my heart and my portion forever." And when you come to Psalm 73, this verse comes at the end of a chapter in which the psalmist is struggling with the fact of suffering and injustice in the world. If you were to read the psalm before that, you would see that the writer looked at righteous people who seemed to just have troubles on him. And then he looked at the wicked people, and it just seemed like that they prospered. And so the early part of the psalm, he shares his confusion. And his cry is, you know, where is God in all of this? Where it seems like bad things happen to good people and good things happen to bad people. And so you ask, where is God in all of this? And the writer was confused until he came to the sanctuary of God. You kind of walk through this, and when he gets to verse 16, God's softening his heart. God's changing his heart. And he says in verse 16, "When I pondered to understand this, it was troublesome in my sight until I came into the sanctuary of God, and then I perceived their end." And so when he came to God's house, as he pondered this struggle, this battle that we all face, then it all began to become clear and to be understood. That evil would one day fail and the righteous would one day ultimately live and or succeed. It doesn't always seem that way as we live life, but the Bible tells us that that will be the outcome. That the uncertain will one day be explained, and that the wrong will one day be made right. And then it's at that point in the psalm where he shares what he shares in verse 26. "My flesh and my heart may fail, but God is the strength of my heart and my portion forever." And so our flesh may fail, our flesh will fail, but God is powerful. He really is the strength of our lives. In fact, this word portion, where he says God is the strength of my heart and my portion, I want to talk about that word for a minute. The word portion there has the idea of an inheritance. And it means that God is the inheritance of all faithful followers. What that would mean to believers is this. It means that what happened to Richard this past Monday morning physically is not the final word. Yes, the death certificate says that he is dead. But you know, there's another record that declares he is in fact more alive right now than he has ever been before. And we see that in John 3:16, where it says, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him would not perish, but have everlasting life." And so that's the record that means more to us than anything. It reminds me of the story of Jesus with Mary and Martha. And you probably remember that story in John 11. Mary and Martha had a brother named Lazarus. They were all close to Jesus, and Lazarus was sick, and they sent word to Jesus that he was sick. And by the time Jesus got there, he had died. And so there is this picture there in John 11 where Jesus comes to the sisters. And in verse 21, Martha said to Jesus, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died." You feel the grief in that statement, don't you? But she went on to say, "Even now I know that whatever you ask of God, God will give you." And Jesus said to her, "Your brother will rise again." And Martha said to him, "I know that he will rise again in the resurrection on the last day." And Jesus said to her, "I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me will live even if he dies. And everyone who lives and believes in me will never die." Now those are words of hope and encouragement and assurance. You see, this record tells us that death is not the end of the journey. It's just simply a bend in the journey. And so when we take the turn and we begin on that new stretch of life, it'll be the best trip that we have ever taken. Richard Wade believed in Jesus Christ. And so what's happened to him? Well, the Bible tells us that he has simply changed addresses, right? From a house there south of Elk City to the room which has been prepared for him by the Father. Crossing over from death into life. In fact, I love how Jesus puts it in John 5, 24. He said, "Truly, truly, I say to you, he that hears my word and believes on him that sent me has everlasting life, and shall not come into judgment, but is passed from death into life." And so our flesh may fail, but God is powerful. He is the God of resurrection. And so what does God promise then for those who believe in Jesus as Lord and Savior? Well, there's the last word there in verse 26 that I want to read to you. Here's God's promise. "My flesh and my heart may fail, but God is the strength of my heart and my portion." Here's the last word. Forever. Forever. Now think about the word forever for a minute. That's God's promise. That means that we're going to live forever if God is our portion. And that means, first of all, that this promise is personal. That God will be with you as you walk this path. This God who made the world, this God who sent his Son to give us eternal life, this God who knows us so well that he even knows the number of hairs on our head, he will be with you. He is your portion. And that's the truth about salvation, isn't it? It's always personal. It's always God dealing with the individual. And what will you do with Jesus? And so it's a personal promise, but also it is a permanent promise. He will be with you forever. So what that means is this: in every lonely night, in every decision, as you work through grief, as you deal with your pain, as you pick up the pieces of life, he will be there. God is the strength of our heart and our portion forever. For every believer, when we die, we are with the Lord. When we live, God is with us. And really, that's what we talk about at Christmas time, right? The man, remember Isaiah gave the prophecy that the virgin will conceive and bear a son, and you will call his name Emmanuel. And then you come to Matthew's gospel, and Matthew quotes that text out of Isaiah written 700 years before Jesus came, and that his name would be called Emmanuel. You know what Emmanuel means? God is with us. That's the message of Christmas. God became flesh and dwelt among us. So he's going to be with you in all the ups and downs, all of the challenges that you face. For the Christian, no matter what happens to us, whether we live or die, God is with us. And so that means that with Jesus Christ, you are never alone. So as we come to this service today, we just thank God for Richard, for his life. I'm not going to tell him goodbye today. I'm just going to say, see you later. See you later. Because the Bible says God is preparing a place for all of his people where we will be together eternally. If you're here at the service today and you don't really know where you stand with the Lord Jesus, knowing Richard like I do, he would want you to know him. And the Bible gives a clear way to heaven, a clear way to know Jesus. The Bible tells us that there is a God, and that this God created this world and the universe and every one of us, over 7 billion people on the planet. And God created all of us and wanted us to have a relationship with him, but sin got in the way. We read that story in Genesis 3 where Adam and Eve disobeyed God and not only cut themselves off from a relationship with God, but every human being that has lived since, our sin gets in the way. And so the way that God solved that problem is to come himself in the flesh, in the person of Jesus Christ. The Bible says that Jesus left heaven, came to this earth, born of a virgin, lived a sinless life, died on the cross to pay for the sins of our sins. And if we're willing to turn from our sin, to acknowledge that we have sinned and repent of it, the Bible says God will forgive us. He'll cleanse our hearts, give us a fresh start. And Jesus can do that for you today if you will just turn from your sin and turn to him. That's God's message. That's what he shares with us. And so I'm so grateful that when we come to a time like this, that we can always remind ourselves of the hope we have in Jesus. That means you all will see Richard again as you know Jesus as your Lord and Savior. And I pray that will comfort you in the days ahead. Let's bow our heads together and go to the Lord in prayer. Father, we thank you today that for the believer in Jesus, that death does not have the final say. We thank you for these great promises from the Word of God. Lord, they give us hope, they give us strength, they give us courage that we need in days like this. Because, Father, we grieve with this family today, but we also know that we grieve, but we don't grieve as those who have no hope because of what Jesus has come and done for us. That he has abolished death and given life and immortality to all of his people through the gospel. And so we gather today grateful that many years ago that Richard settled this question in his heart as he gave his life to Jesus. And Father, we pray for anyone in our midst who needs to make that same commitment. God, we pray for this family today. We love them and we grieve with them. And we pray that you will be with them in these coming days of transition and readjustment. May you send your Holy Spirit to guide every step that they take. Father, we pray they will continue to lean on you, and we know that you have promised to see them through. Be with friends here today who love Richard and care for him, appreciated him. Father, we just look forward to seeing him again someday and pray that you will comfort us through these songs that have been shared and sung and these scriptures that have been shared as well. God, we thank you that you love us in this way. You send your Son to do for us what we couldn't do for ourselves. Thank you, Father. We pray all of you in Jesus' name.
Tell the world. Getting to be too many of these.